Good afternoon. Welcome to the FCCJ Professional Luncheon. I'm Kazuo Abiko, former FCCJ president. Before I introduce our guest speaker today, I would like you to make sure your mobile phone is turned off or on the silent mode at least. Okay, thank you. Now, it is my great pleasure to introduce Mr. Haruna, Mikio Haruna, a distinguished journalist and university professor. Mr. Haruna had been with Kyodo News for 38 years, from 1969 through 2007. During his career with Kyodo, he served as correspondent in New York and Washington, chief of bureau in Washington, deputy chief editorial writer, and the prestigious title, the special correspondent. During his tenure as Washington COB, he interviewed President Bill Clinton, who now is known better as husband of Hillary Clinton. Meanwhile, he received two prestigious awards for his outstanding journalistic activities: the Von Waseda International Journalist Award in 1995, and the Japan National Press Club Award in 2004. Following his retirement from Kyodo, Mr. Haruna became professor at the Graduate School of Languages and Cultures of Nagoya University, and then visiting professor at the Graduate School of Political Science of Waseda University. He has published books on various subjects, including U.S.-Japan relations. His latest book, titled Masked U.S.-Japan Alliance, in Japanese, it's a Kamen no Nichibei Domei, was published just last year. By the way, if you would like to purchase the latest book, about 15 copies are available at the front desk, if you wish. Today, as announced in the event notice, he's going to talk about illusion about Japan, U.S. Security Alliance. As you know, Japan's new security laws were enacted last fall, while massive protests against the enactment were staged outside the Diet day after day. I will refrain from expressing my opinions about Mr. Abe, but I'm sure Mr. Haruna have a lot to say about him. The guest speaker has been arguing that laws were based on false assumptions or misunderstandings. He will explain why he believes so. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Mikio Haruna.
Thank you very much for kind introduction, Mr. Abiko. His office was quite next to ours about 10 years ago. Anyway, thank you for coming today. And I would like to share new informations with you on new security laws. In the Diet last year, more than 200 hours over 4 months were spent deliberating the security legislation. Main issues debated then were constitutionality of the new laws and physical safety of SDF, self-defense forces, troops, who will be doing logistic support for the U.S. armed forces. But the most important issue was not discussed. That's what I think. That is, how would Japan herself be defended under the new arrangements? The debates were not enough. Today, I'd like to share with you important facts which are not well known among the people. First of all, the Japan's new security laws are based on the wrong assumptions. Mr. Abe's rationale is just in the page 3 of my resume delivered to you today. Please take a look at the 3 downward arrows. Number 1, the U.S. forces will defend Japan if Japan is attacked. He thinks, by the way, Japan's U.S. security treaty is a one-sided treaty. In other words, not fully mutual. Because the United States is obliged to defend Japan if Japan is attacked, while Japan does not have to defend the United States under the treaty, even if U.S. is attacked. Number 2, that is why he has argued that Japan should exercise the right of collective self-defense. Number 3, then the alliance will function perfectly. He just said, because mutuality is met. Number 4, and the new arrangements will further enhance deterrence for Japan. I think this is a kind of a naive idea for a prime minister. Officially, Japan-U.S. security treaty is a mutually obligated treaty. Article 6 of the treaty is clear about Japan's obligation to provide the facilities and areas in Japan to the U.S. armed forces. You cannot underestimate this kind of burden, but Mr. Abe might feel owed to U.S. kind of emotionally. The second issue is about Japan-U.S. defense guidelines. I found the guidelines was erroneously translated from English into Japanese in line with those assertions of the Prime Minister. So I will talk about the distorted translations next. The Prime Minister proposed the security laws after Japan and the U.S. agreed on the new guidelines for Japan-U.S. defense cooperation. The guidelines is an executive agreement which does not require the Diet ratification or approval. But the guidelines are still important because it contains a lot of specifics of operations for the two nations, which regulate the operations of both armed forces. We need to pay attention to the contents of the guidelines. Big surprise for me in my research is that I found a lot of distorted translations from English into Japanese. The first description that I feel strange about is following sentence. I think the somewhere in my resume. Anyway, the following sentence: Japan's SDF self-defense forces will defend Japan, 主体的に. If Japan is attacked, 主体的に means spontaneously, but it sounds inadequate for such document. Then I checked the English version of the guidelines and found original language, which is Japan's primary responsibility for defending Japan. In the Japanese version, primary responsibility was omitted. In the Japan-U.S. negotiations on the guidelines, both of the parties should have agreed on Japan's primary responsibility. Deletion of these words may be for the purpose to coordinate between United States and the government of Japan's positions and Japanese public opinions. Other descriptions, I think, distorted supplement to hokan. Hokan means complement. Bilateral operations to kyodo sakusen, joint operations. May to dekiru, can. There may be more. In the case of joint operations, English version of 1978 guidelines said SDF self-defense forces and US forces will jointly conduct operations for the defense of Japan, as shown on the bottom of page 4. I presume that US engagement in the defense of Japan has been gradually retreating, and SDF's defense posture has been changing more proactively. The most important distortion among them is that Japan's responsibility for defending Japan is lost in translation. Next, I would like to touch upon the unclassified documents. About 8 years ago, I found a very important document at the National Archives too, in the suburbs of Washington, D.C., which is on page 2. This document says U.S. forces in Japan are not there to defend Japan proper. At that time, Okinawa has not returned back to Japan. So in this case, Japan proper. In the bracket, that is Japan's own responsibility. This is from the original document. But instead, for the strategic defense of Korea, Taiwan, and Southeast Asia, unlike NATO, there are no joint command arrangements and no joint planning of any kind in Japan. Thus, our bases in Japan and Okinawa are almost entirely for U.S. forces, logistic purposes, and serve to defend Japan only in the broadest strategic sense. This is a memorandum for the President Nixon, just about a week before his meeting with Prime Minister Sato. And this document was signed by Acting Secretary U. Alexis Johnson, dated on December 29, 1971. Mr. Johnson had been a respected ambassador to Japan, and became undersecretary back in Washington, D.C., and temporarily acting secretary during Secretary Rogers' absence. This document clearly describes that defending Japan is Japan's responsibility. Responsibility is really a key word. Also, in the negotiation of the guidelines, I think U.S. probably argued that responsibility should be mentioned in the guidelines. I have kept this document in my file for 8 years, and last year I came to recognize a kind of linkage between this document and the guidelines. Other documents on page 4 also refers to the role of U.S. forces based in Japan. Quite similarly, three documents have the same lines that U.S. forces in Japan are not there to defend Japan. But these descriptions are quite contrary to Mr. Abe's assertion, as I said earlier today. Probably this is why government of Japan needs to do erroneous translation intentionally. Next subject will be on senkaku disputes. The reason why U.S. does not recognize Japan's sovereignty over senkaku is now clear. It was not clear even for me. The point is very simple. It is in Article 1 of the agreement between Japan and the United States of America concerning the Ryukyu Islands and the Daito Islands. It refers only to the return of all powers of administration to Japan, not sovereignty, all powers of administration. The agreement does not mention sovereignty at all. In my research for the book, I came to know that my old friend of mine of the State Department wrote the draft agreement. He disclosed that U.S. would not like to be involved in the territorial disputes among three parties, Japan, China, Taiwan, concerning senkaku. Ambassador Army Myers' memoir, Assignment Tokyo. On the book, in page 49, also points out as follows. The United States position, carefully reflected in the documentation, was that as custodians, we were merely returning administrative power to Japan without prejudice to historic claims. This neat position endeared us to none of the three disputants, but it assured our non-involvement in a controversy which is likely to continue for years. The precarious situation around senkaku now are just as the ambassador predicted. When the Defense Secretary of United States, Leon Panetta, visited Japan in September 16th, 2012, Washington Post reported about the remarks of a senior U.S. military official from Tokyo. He was reported to have sat on the condition of anonymity to discuss deliberations within the Obama administration. And I quote, "I'm pretty frank with people. I don't think that we would allow the United States to get dragged into a conflict over fish or a rock." And he added, "Having allies that we have defense treaties with, not allowing them to drag us into a situation over a rock dispute is something I think we are pretty all well aligned on." President Obama, as you know, stressed on April 24th, 2014, 2 years ago, when he had a joint press conference with Prime Minister Abe, he said, and let me reiterate that our treaty commitment to Japan's security is absolute, and Article 5 covers all territories under Japan's administration, including the Senkaku Islands. He repeated the same remarks in the White House April 28th last year. But I think he does not sound persuasive. China has sent more ships of its government close to Senkaku's even after the president's expression of defense commitment to Japan. I just hope that both allies should talk candidly and deeply about the serious ways to prevent clash between Japan and China. That's all for today. Thank you so much for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Haruna. Now, floor is open for questions. First, we will take questions from the members of the working press. And please identify yourself and your affiliation. And we accept only questions, no speeches, please. Any questions?
Kobayashi, freelancer. Could you kindly explain, or your guess, why the Japanese government and Japanese authorities deleted or intentionally deleted or misinterpreted the documents? And what do you, how do you explain the intention of the government? Especially Abe administration. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kobayashi. I think the deletion was done intentionally to accommodate with Abe's speech remarks and the Japanese public opinion. Japanese people believe that the United States will defend us when Japan is attacked. So this kind of responsibility for Japanese SDF to defend Japan is not kind of well understood by the Japanese people. That's why they intentionally changed the translated words. Thank you.
Okay, any other questions? Yes.
Hi, Hello, my name is Sophie Jackman from Kyodo News, and thank you for your talk today. I would like to ask why you think this information was kept hidden from the public for so long. Is the reporting insufficient? And if so, why? And how do you think this information from now will actually affect Japanese public opinion? Or will it? And why do you think that is? Thank you.
Thank you very much. The media people, reporters, were briefed by Gaimusho and defense ministry officials only by Japanese version of the guidelines, not English version. And still, it seems to me Japanese reporters do not have not read English version of the guidelines. This is Sunday's Asahi Shimbun. this says self-defense forces will spontaneously do operations in line with the guidelines. So it doesn't say anything about primary responsibility or something like that. Still, they believe SDF will act spontaneously. So they don't know yet. And even they haven't read my book yet.
Yes, right.
My name is Gregory Clark, freelance. I appreciate very much what you had to say about the Senkaku. The remarks by Panetta were not noticed at the time, I think, and are very relevant. But what's happened over remarks about the Senkakus have changed a lot over the years, in which are they accurate? What really reflect the American position is not clear, except that at the time of the reversion of Okinawa, it was pretty clear that the only administration was returned. I want to come back to your, you make a big point of the use of shutaiteki as being spontaneously. That's a strange translation. On the contrary, it has the meaning of doing things of your own accord, getting up and doing things, something. And I also have connections with Japanese universities, and we constantly use that word about the students, that they should get up and do things. It never has the meaning of spontaneously, that they, of their own accord, should do things. Why have you, where did you get this strange word, spontaneously?
Shutaiteki is a really difficult word to translate into English. That's what I thought. And I was not, you know, I'm still vague in that sense. So thank you for helping me. I think I may change the proper English word for that.
Okay. Any other questions? If there's no question, you have a follow-up question? Okay.
Well, actually, shutaiteki is stronger than the English, actually. It implies that Japan will of its own accord do something, but I won't argue with you about that. I want to ask you a much deeper, profound question about this whole question of alliance to help if Japan is attacked. In today's world, nobody is not attacked without a reason. Sometimes the reasons are good, sometimes the reasons are bad. America has taken uses the word preemptive attack. In other words, it's allowed to attack if it believes that the other side is evil. There is, in all the talk between Japan and America about defending against attack, either attack on America or attack on Japan, there is, have you ever seen any reference to, first of all, we need to look at the reasons for the attack before we agree to help to defend? America has attacked, has been attacked by other people, often for very good reasons. But there's no mention of that. Has there ever been any discussion that the reasons for the attack should also be noted?
I think that is a kind of a academic question, I did not intend to speak today. So I'm sorry, I have no answer to that. Reasons, there are many reasons. Territorial reasons or other reasons like revenge or something like that. But in cases Senkakus and others, probably territorial intentions maybe could be main reasons for some countries to attack, but clear-cut attack might not happen in Senkaku areas. That's what I presume. Because Chinese boats, including fishing boat and or patrol boats, are coming to watch Senkaku Islands. They haven't attacked Senkaku Islands yet, but I think they may be waiting for Japanese self-defense forces or some other organizations might make mistakes. And then they may take a chance to seize the islands. That might happen, only a possibility. Thank you. I didn't answer to your question, sorry.
Okay. Jimbo-san.
Thank you, Terry Jimbo with the video news. My question is, where does the Japanese government, especially the bureaucracy, stands on all of this? You said the Japanese reporters are lectured, briefed on the Japanese version of the accord so that they are misled. But so what's the meaning of this Japanese version of agreement? Is that just a wishful thinking of Japanese bureaucracy, or they actually believe that that's what the agreement means? You know, I really want to know. Their bureaucracies are also misled, or they know what the agreement actually is, but they are only trying to manipulate the Japanese public opinion by misleading it. Thank you.
The actually guidelines are the third version. The first one was in 1978. And second one was 1997, and this one is 2015. And the versions of 1997 and 2015 are quite similar. And this time, I made a question to a friend of mine who is with the Gaimusho, and I said to him, this is strange. And he said, the guidelines are just quite same as 1997. So last year when they translated, I think they just copied the 1997 version. And they didn't think seriously or deeply at all. That's what I thought, but 1997, they decided to put a Japanese language in that way. I think they thought seriously, not to incite any controversy among the people. So this is a kind of a usual tactics done by Gaimisho. At the end of World War II, conditions of unconditional surrender was actually compromised. And at that time, the Secretary of State, James Burns, sent a telegram that the authorities of Japanese government and the emperor will be subject to the supreme commander of Allied forces. At that time, Gaimisho said in Japanese, the powers of authorities of Japanese government and emperor will be limited, not a subject to supreme commander of Allied forces. So in Japanese, Tenno to Nihon Seifu no Kengen wa Seigen no Moto ni Okareru. But the Ministry of the Army did the very correct translation. They said the Tenno to Seifu no Kengen wa Rengo Kokugun Saikou Shireikan ni Reizoku suru. So they, I think they needed a kind of consensus within the government. That's why they did that kind of a wrong translation. At the San Francisco Peace Treaty, also, the government of Japan accept the English version. Japanese government will accept the judgment of the Tokyo Tribunal. But the Gaimisho did not translate judgment. They just said Nihon Seifu wa saiban wo ukeireru. No judgment at all in Japanese version. This happens quite often. Not often, maybe sometimes. I hope.
Yes.
Hi, I'm sorry. Just following up the second part of my initial question. Do you think that if the Japanese public develops a perception that they are being deceived and that Prime Minister Abe's perception of the guidelines is different to what it actually is, do you think this will make a difference in the Japanese public's perception of him? Do you think going into the election it would be enough to turn the tide or not, and why? Thank you.
I think this could be a very big issue if they come to know the truth. But there are some conditions. If your reporters report correctly about the true picture of the guidelines, then people come to know, and maybe in the Diet, opposition parties make questions. Then they may lose some support. The government may lose some support. That's what I thought.
Let me ask a follow-up question, Mr. Arnott. If the information provided by the government is not really forthcoming or deceptive, then what do you think of the role of the press, about informing the general public what is going on?
Role of press was not fully implemented in this case. I actually give this book to some reporters, but they did not report about it, unfortunately. So, I think the constructive role of the press was not developed in this case.
Is that because of the, worked for the foreign press, usually think that the Japanese press are too close to the news sources, I mean the government, and is that the reason or what?
And this case also, the if they report about the true picture, they would, I think, they would permit their feeders what they did when they reported about guidelines last year.
Okay. Kobayashi-san, sorry, please.
My question is related to the questions of Abiko-san and the lady. Can you find unprejudiced media people who can share your idea without any prejudice? Just we should know the facts, the reality. And do you think that you can find these people who are journalists, media?
Very difficult question, but a good question. Mm. I think the I'm really willing to share these facts with the any journalist. Please help me in that sense.
Well, you know, I had been working for the AP, and I've been very familiar with the so-called objective journalism that practiced by major American news organizations, and so that's they of course, as Mr. Kobayashi explained, there's no perfect objectivity. Of course, you can. It's hard to imagine. However, you should strive to be objective. You should strive to provide accurate information as, you know, as much as possible. And if you don't, didn't find enough information, and later you found new information, you should report about it. I think that's what the press should stand for. Thank you. Yes, Jimbo-san. Oh, sorry, Jimbo-san. Wait a minute. Sorry, you have to ask one question. Please. Oh, Jimbo-san, please. Okay.
Sorry, second question. Let me clarify if I understood it correctly. So Japan has the primary responsibilities to defend its islands under the guideline. And U.S.-Japan Security Treaty only takes effect for the territories under the administration of Japan. So does that mean that if some country, China, attacks, say, Senkaku Island, Japan has to defend it, primarily at least. And then if the island is occupied by the government of China, it is no longer under the administration of Japan, so that it is not the subject to the U.S.-Japan Security Treaty. Is that your logic that you mentioned this is a primary responsibility and administration, under the administration clause? Thank you.
Also a very good question. What happened after the seizure of Senkaku by Chinese Navy or somebody else? The Japan self-defense forces and U.S. Navy have been doing joint maneuvers to regain the Senkaku Islands several times before. I think these are not quite the joint operations. Probably the U.S. Navy is teaching Japanese SDF the way how to regain the Senkaku Islands. So with regard to the Senkaku Islands, United States has not recognized its sovereignty of Japan. And so they would not be so willing to participate in the operations to regain the Senkaku Islands. So probably in that case, I think the politics might decide for U.S. about the how U.S. would act. So some cases, I'm not sure. At this moment, I cannot predict the correct situations surrounding the Senkaku Islands, but United States will think or discuss how to react. If it's very important for U.S. to protect the administrative rights of Japan over Senkaku, they may act. So it's up to United States.
Okay, I think it's about time to open floor for the non-members, non-working press members, please. But yes.
Haruna-san, Thomas Sullivan, associate member. You talked about the disputes between Taiwan, China, and Japan around the Senkaku Islands. I was just wondering as well if you could give us your perspectives on North Korea from a practical perspective. If, for instance, North Korea was to attack Niigata, where U.S. don't have strategic interests, what do you think the outcome might be? And also, of course, there's a territorial dispute between Russia and Japan as well in the northern territories. Could you give us your perspective on what the U.S. position might be as far as that goes? And for the bases, obviously, if they're not there to protect Japanese interests, why is Japan paying for them? I mean, there's an election going on at the moment. Mr. Trump is obviously saying countries need to, pay their own bills. So are there implications there as well from what you've been saying?
Okay.
Sorry about all.
Okay. I think I'm not able to answer all the questions. Anyway, the number one issue is about North Korea. I think the Xi Jinping of China is now thinking how to react to the new situation in North Korea. I think he will decide how to react to Kim Jong-un. And in that case, one of the most important facts involving North Korean Peninsula is that Lee Myung-bak, the former president of South Korea, seems to have promised to Hu Jintao, a former president of China, that if the North Korea collapses, the U.S. armed forces, even if North Korea collapses, the U.S. armed forces would not go north beyond the 38th degrees. Which means a very good promise for Chinese. And look at the relation between China and South Korea these years. Last year, the Park Geun-hye, President Park Geun-hye, participated in the military parade in Beijing last year. And South Korea and China are much, much closer now. Xi Jinping might think the North Korea may collapse sometime, but that not be the worst case for him, because South Korea is closer to China. That's what I can say at this moment. And Russian Northern Territories, I think the Japan lost a very good chance when Gorbachev said to Mr. Ozawa and some other Japanese politicians, Japan at that time had a policy. If Russia returns Northern Territories, Japan would give economic assistances, huge amount of economic supports. And Gorbachev said, politics is art of possibility, which means how about vice versa? If Japan gives economic support to Russia, Russia may be willing to return Northern Territories, but no Japanese politicians had the guts to do that deal. And the United States position is so, I think, sensitive in those negotiations and prospects for Northern Territories. Before the Okinawa Revolution, United States opposed return of Northern Territories from Soviet Union to Japan. But after the, around from the time of Reagan administration, they supported the Japanese demands for return of Northern Territories. And so the geopolitics, you know, changes time to time. So at this moment, I am not sure about the Northern Territories ideas which United States has in politics. Sorry about that.
Yes.
My name is Minoru Moko from IDCJ. IDCJ means International Development Center of Japan. Mainly the job of IDCJ is the ODA job from JICA. And thank you for this. You know, I'm a member of your Osaka University's OB club. So thank you for inviting this lunch event. And my question is very simple. You know, first of all, your argument, your primary argument of the misunderstanding of the American attitude to defending Japan. And I totally agree with you. But my argument is the Japanese general opinion, I mean the common sense about, will know the this kind of fact, but this kind of happy happy confidence will be widely accepted. You know, German people, America, United States will defend Japan, first of all. You know, this kind of common, you know, first of all, this...
I'm sorry, what was your question?
Yeah. So the this misunderstanding, it came from the mainly MOFA, Gaimisho, or Prime Minister Abe, or Japanese politician, but the Japanese, don't you think Japanese opinion, I mean the general sense, in common sense, means will widely accepted this happy confidence, I should say. What do you think?
I don't know your question exactly, but anyway, I think the Gaimisho is using these guidelines as a useful tool to persuade Japanese public. That's it, and. If Japanese people dissent the translation, the contents of the translation, I think then they will think how to react. I mean, so far, their maneuvers, of deletion or mistranslation or something like that, have been going so well for them. But I think the journalists have to do is to let the people know the truth, not the wrong ideas. I think we had a very bad history during those time. The war went on, and lots of people died, and I think the people should know the realities. That's it.
Okay, I think we have one more question, please.
Makoto Honju, associate. Could I understand it that your position is that the Japanese government has been consistently having a double talk situation where they will provide A information to the Japanese public in Japanese, which is sometimes a little bit sort of twisted from the original language, and do you think that is a way for the Japanese government or the administration to manage the vagaries of the international geopolitics?
I did not mean they do all the time. Not always. Sometimes they do. And important occasions, they did this time. So that's why I need to let the things corrected. That's my idea.
Okay, here, I expect one more question. Yes.
Mitsuya Goto, an old associate member, now a life member of this club. Thank you very much for the presentation of your clear views in easily understood English. The question I want to ask is how do you resolve the Futenma air base issue? Are you in line with what the Prime Minister Shinzo Abe and Defense Minister Gen Nakatani are saying? Or are you sympathetic to Governor Onaga of Okinawa?
Thank you. You gave me a more difficult question. And I think the start of the discussion about the Futenma returning to Japan, that at that time Governor Japan made a mistake. The start was the September 4th, 1995, when the schoolgirl was actually had a difficult time by the Marine soldiers, three Marine soldiers. And at that time, Okinawa had big demonstrations. One time, more than 100,000 people gathered. 100,000 people means 10% of the entire population of Okinawa Prefecture. They, at that time, the first side, United States or Japan, first the people who thought Futenma should be returned to Japan was not government of Japan, but United States government. I was based in Washington, D.C. at that time. But usually, United States would not initiate the discussion of returning or something, or yielding or something, because United States is a superpower. United States would not bowing out. In case of Senkaku, you know, Futenma, I interviewed Richard Armitage October 1995. At that time, he said Futenma should be returned. And this was not a big news, but it was reported widely in Okinawa newspapers and broadcasting stations. And at that time, one of the broadcasting stations called me up, and they would like to invite Armitage to Okinawa. And probably he went to Okinawa, down to Okinawa, and made speeches. But anyway, at that time, Clinton White House did not have Japan experts at all. So they invited Armitage to White House and listened to him what is the best solution to base issues. And then the next year, Clinton visited Tokyo. Before his visit, Prime Minister Hashimoto and Mr. Clinton had talks in Santa Monica in California. At that time, before the meeting, the Gaimusho people opposed that Hashimoto would propose the return of Futenma. And they tried to stop Hashimoto from talking about that. But in the meeting, in the last minute, Clinton said, "Do you have something else to talk to me?" That's why Hashimoto proposed, "Why don't we discuss about return of Futenma?" Then they started talking about Futenma. And in the beginning, the Futenma was to be integrated into Kadena. But Kadena is Air Force. Futenma is Marine. They are not in good terms at all. So Air Force opposed it. So 2 months later, this idea didn't go well. So they thought how to react to those new situation. But that time, government of Japan said the security treaty, Article 6, Japan has the obligation to provide the facilities or bases to United States Armed Forces. So that's our responsibility. So they took responsibility to find out the replacement of Futenma. From that on, I mean, more than 20 years. Almost 20 years, yeah, 20 years. The problem is still going on. Japan, why did Japan have to shoulder this burden? I know the security treaty, Article 6 is there, but this is a specific problems. United States wanted to propose, but Japanese initiated this issue. So I think the government of Japan was not good at handling this issue well in 1996. That's it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your insightful presentation and the answers to some of the tough questions too. And you know, this event was conducted in English because this club, the club's official language is English, but I want you to know our Japanese is pretty good. And normally we will present honorary membership to our guest speaker, but Mr. Haruna is a member, so so we are presenting a bottle of wine for the appreciation for your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.